All right, Matthew chapter number 5. Matthew chapter number 5. Now, we are getting into a very difficult section of the Sermon on the Mount. Today, murder and sins of the heart. Next week, divorce. War, riches, everyday issues that we live with. So before we even start, I need to remind you of a couple of things. We all need to thank God for grace.
Amen.
Amen? There's not a just man that doeth good and sinneth not. There was only one that ever lived that did not have sin and failure in their life. First John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 Corinthians 11:30 and 31, if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. Isaiah 1:18, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord, though your sins be scarlet, they should be as wool, though they be red as crimson, they should be white as snow. Hebrews 4:16, my text again at the preaching hour. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. I don't know why and what it is about the American culture in our churches that the sin of murder and divorce are treated as being sins that are not forgivable. That's not in the Bible. That's not in the Bible. True, God says, I hate divorce. But he hates a lot of other sins too. I don't know what it is about our American culture that those two particular sins are zeroed in on as taboo to talk about, let alone preach forgiveness. I plan to give these a very honest look. But I thought I might start out by mentioning the grace of God. Where sin doth abound, grace doth much more abound. And I may hit upon something that your particular life has not been touched by a certain sin or problem. But let's all of us be careful to remember we're sinners saved by the grace of God. Amen. Mm-hmm. There are no perfect people. Not the guy up here, not the folks I'm looking at. None of us have anything to glory in except the cross of Jesus Christ, the shed blood of Jesus Christ, the mercy of the Lord, and the grace of God. Amen?
Amen.
So, let's take a look at this one today. Verse 21. In 26, let me read it first and we'll work through it. You have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not kill. Well, we know that's what it says in Exodus 20. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. I'll get back to that in a minute. Because in the Old Testament, if you murder, the punishment was blood for blood on the law. The prohibition against murder was obviously never rescinded. And the Bible does teach capital punishment.
Amen.
We are now a society that is moving away from capital punishment. Isn't that strange?
Yes.
Kill babies and not. Yeah. Kill someone and go to jail for 5 years, and the anti-capital punishment crowd says, well, to kill someone that's murdered is cruel punishment. Duh. What about what they did to that woman or to that child? We're nuts. Sin has made us crazy. Capital punishment was never rescinded because in the New Testament, Paul, by divine inspiration, in Romans 13 said, the government does not bear the sword in vain.
Amen.
What do you do with a sword? Give the kid a spanking? Not hardly. Instrument of execution. But I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of the hell fire. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there remembers that thy brother hath ought against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift.
Amen.
Agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. Murder. The Lord is basically saying there's a whole lot more to murder than taking a gun and shooting someone and killing them. See, remember the basic problem the Lord was dealing with, that the preachers and the religious leaders of his day were, they were only concerned with the outward act. Never the inward whatever. Out of the heart proceeds murder, adultery, theft, etc., etc., etc. And the Lord deals with the cause, not just the effect and the result. First of all, let me say this. There ain't a man, woman, boy, or girl alive that's ever kept the law. Okay, you haven't killed anybody. But you've been angry at somebody. That's heart murder. So, there's only one that ever walked among men that fulfilled
Amen.
The law perfectly. In his own body, in Jesus Christ. We have fulfilled the law when we run into Christ. But outside of Christ, there is not a human being that's ever lived a perfect life. Whosoever therefore shall offend in one point of the law, James 2:10, he's guilty of all. The law is strict. The law, the breaking of the law, does not allow for mercy. But Christ fulfilled it. And when we're in Christ, the Father no longer looks at us as lawbreakers. He looks at us as his children in Christ. And the blood covers. It's under the blood. So, first of all, the command itself. You have heard that it was said unto thee of old time, thou shalt not kill. The moral law is good today. All the Ten Commandments except the one about the Sabbath are repeated by the Lord or by the apostles or by Paul in the New Testament. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not lust, thou shalt not covet, thou shalt not... Those are all in force today. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. Well, that's true. But the judgment under the law was death. Here's a scary verse that America needs to be thinking about out of Deuteronomy and number. The blood that is shed in the land cannot be cleansed but by the blood of him that shed the innocent blood. That's the law. That's what it says. That's what it means.
Yeah.
You surely have been watching the fiasco on the news about the young man that drove drunk and killed four people and he got probation. First of all, let's get off of this, oh well, they're so young, we can't do that. If they're young enough to commit murder, they're young enough to pay the price.
That's right.
Hello out there?
Yes. Amen.
Don't tell me a 14-year-old kid or a 16-year-old kid can go out, kill people, and then come back and say, oh, but he's just a child. Are you kidding? That's the law. That's the law. And without Christ, there would be no forgiveness. Oh, here's another one we hear a lot. Well, he got saved in prison, so we owe him another chance. No, you don't. What about his victim? What about his victim? The law. You kill, you die. That's the law. Now then, here's the thing. God is the giver of life. God has put a hedge around humanity. And God said, you can't take another person's life. Only I can do that. California now, and another state up north somewhere, now they've legalized euthanasia. You know what that is? Killing old people. Assisted suicide. It's wrong. It's wrong. By the way, do a little history study. After baby killing, and let assisted suicide is next. After that, it's what Hitler did. People that had physical infirmity, that were a burden to the state, they killed them. That's wrong. Only God has that right. Only God has that right. So, the command itself. Now here's the explanation, or the exposition of this law, by the Jewish religious leader, which the Lord had to correct. They dealt only with the act of killing someone. They never dealt with the sinful thought or the heart that gave rise to the actual act. So here is the Lord's exposition. Verse 22, but I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. Heart murder. God says the thought, if you sincerely desire in your heart to kill somebody, you're already guilty of murder. That's God's law. And then notice this. Whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council, but whosoever shall say, thy fool shall be in danger of hell fire. Tongue murder. To say someone, Raca means a worthless one. Fool is not what you and I would call a fool today, but without God, someone that is so bad they're without God's protection. Heart murder, tongue murder. Because out of the heart come the issues of life. Now, verse 23 and 24 are very difficult. I'm going to read them again, then explain them. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, so now, see, we're talking to the Christian community here. Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there remembers that thy brother hath ought against thee, leave there thy gift before the council. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Agree with thy adversary quickly whilst thou art in the way with him. First of all, the goal between people is Christian love and peace. When we are out of sorts with someone, peace is broken. Communion is broken. And by the way, if you really look at this, God would rather you and I be at peace with each other. God would rather there be love amongst each other than for you to put $1 million check in the offering plate. See, to the religious leaders, outward religion or whatever was what was important. To the Lord, inward is more important. And then let it work out to the outside. Now, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, coming to church, worshiping, singing, giving, teaching, whatever. And there remembers that thy brother hath ought against thee. Somebody's mad at you. Leave thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First, you're reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. So the Lord changes the order completely around. I haven't killed anybody this week. I haven't committed adultery this week, so I'm fine this morning. But wait a minute, what's gone through our hearts this week? And secondly, who's out there that won't come to church because, well, they go to church there and we got a bad relationship? The point is the importance of being right with God, the importance of being right with your fellow man. Now, when you take all of the Sermon on the Mount together, here is what it does not say. Let's say I'm mad and I'm going to use Brother Ron for example. Let's say he and I have had words this week and we're mad at each other. He's mad at me or I'm mad at him. And here we are on Sunday acting like all is well when it's not. This does not say if I don't get things right with Ron, I'm going to lose my salvation. It does not say that. You cannot lose your salvation. But it does say the fellowship is broken and we need to get it right. And it does say if we really have received grace, we'll give grace. Suppose he robbed me of 50 bucks this week. First of all, the Bible says, let him have it. Forget it. You need to study 1 Corinthians chapter 6. By the way, don't borrow money. Don't loan money that you can't afford to lose.
That's right, yeah.
If you can't afford to lose 50 bucks, somebody comes to you and says, I need 50 bucks. You say, I don't have it. Christians do not loan expecting back, and Christians do not loan expecting back with interest. You see a brother have need, give it. Give it, expecting nothing back. And you sure never take a Christian brother or sister to court. 1 Corinthians 6. Why do ye not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? See, there's more to this business of getting saved. There's a reason Jesus said, before you come after me, you better count the cost. Sometimes it can get real expensive being a Christian, amen? The gist of the whole sermon on the mount is this. You got Christ in here, you will forgive. You got Christ in here, you will make an effort to make it right. You got Christ in here, you will extend grace to an erring brother. We don't see things like this anymore, though I think it would be nice if we would. I remember as a child at the Aaron Avenue Baptist Church, that was a strange church, it was a German-English congregation. And the old church had three sections of pews. All the German folks sat over here, in this side, and all the English-speaking folks sat over here in the middle, was empty because they wouldn't have anything to do with each other. And you always knew when there was a visitor in the church because they didn't know what was going on. They sat in the middle of the line. Well, to say the least, the church was cold as snow. And so a young seminary student from Sioux City, South Dakota, where the North American Baptist Convention had their seminary, came to do a revival. And during the second week of the revival, finally some guys who had been at odds with each other started crossing lines and getting right with God and getting right with each other. And revival broke out in the church. See, God is much more interested in what's going on in here with you and me, okay? Where nobody can see it, only God can see it. But God's much more interested in this right here. So, leave thy gift before the altar. Go thy way. First be ready to talk to the brother, then come and offer thy gift. If you're not right with God, you can still give, you can still be here, but you don't have the blessing of God. Get things right in here, and sometimes with a Christian brother or sister, and everything's going to be okay. That's where God puts the emphasis. Now, the danger is broken communion, not loss of salvation. By the way, a real Christian will be grieved over a broken communion.
Amen.
A real Christian will be grieved over a broken communion between people. And a real Christian will be grieved over broken communion with the Lord. So there is a threefold application to this. Number one, temporal acts, activity between people, like loaning money or borrowing something and not giving it back, or breaking something that belongs to somebody else. As believers, we have a responsibility to be reasonable with other people. If you borrowed something, take it back. If you broke something, offer to pay for it. We have a reasonable responsibility to treat our fellow man right. Second thing is spiritual acts. If there are spiritual problems, somebody has offended you and you've never forgiven them, or or some misunderstanding and some relationship broken, God wants that fixed. We have a responsibility. And by the way, well, so-and-so hurt my feelings, so they're going to have to come to me. I'm sure not going to them. Wrong. 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 They don't go to you, go to them. Go to them. Fix it. Your prayer life is shot if you don't. Your communion with the Lord is shot if you don't. Your joy in here is disrupted. Spiritual relationships are extremely important. And then there is another very important application. And I'm going to read beginning in verse 25 and 6. Agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. Well, first of all, you violate the law, and if you don't go to the law and make some effort to make it right, eventually you're going to catch you and you're going to go to jail. But there is a much more serious application here. First of all, God is an adversary to sinners. Sinners violate the law of God. He that believeth not is condemned. It is the responsibility of sinners to humble themselves before the Lord. Confess Him. Confess to Him our sin. Receive His forgiveness. Romans 10, 9 and 10. It says do it quickly. Do it now. Do it now. Today is the day of salvation. And to continue in a state of enmity to God is fatal. The wages of sin is death. Here is really a great salvation message, a great salvation appeal. Now, in conclusion of the Sunday school lesson, let me read you some encouraging scriptures about believers' relationships with each other, whether that's marriage, whether that's on the job, whether that's here in the church, whatever. Here's what the Lord says in Romans 5:2, but walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for sweet-smelling savior. Colossians 3:14, and above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. 1 Peter 4:8, and above all things, have fervent love among yourselves, for love shall cover the multitude of sins. Someone said this, and I'm about time. I'm going to read it, so I deliberately brought my notes, so I don't miss any of this. How do Christians conduct themselves together? Well, number one, you receive one another. Romans 15:7, wherefore receive one another, as Christ also received us, to the glory of God. Boy, I don't know about y'all, but boy, when I got saved, I was a young mess. Not anything lovely about me, but the Lord received me. Now how dare I not receive others in Christ? You get the picture? Number two, need to esteem one another. In lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Well, I'll tell you what, if we just practice this one verse right here, in lowliness of mind, let each esteem esteem other better than themselves. There'd never be another spat in the home. There'd never another be a fuss on the job. There'd never be another church quarrel. I mean, it would be heaven on earth. Number three, consider one another. Hebrews 10:24. Let us consider one another to what? To provoke unto love. Ye edify one another. Romans 14:19. Let us follow after things wherewith one may edify another. Improve each other, in other words. Number five, exhort one another. Hebrews 3:13. But exhort one another daily, lest any of you be deceived through the deceitfulness of sin. Exhort one another. Number six, admonish one another. Romans 15:4. Able also to admonish one another. And here's a tough one, but boy, this is a good one. Number seven, submit to one another. Submit yourselves one to another in the fear of God. What the Lord say? He said, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have loved one for another. There's a verse that says, yielding pacifieth great anger. The heart. Man doesn't care much about the heart. God cares very much about the heart. So, tough lesson. Next one will really be tough. But we'll work through it and remember the grace of God and the mercy of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Amen.